Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Provost Jim Clark, and I'm very pleased to welcome you all this afternoon to this year's D'Alembert and Palmer Lecture in International Human Rights. I had the honor of attending last year's inaugural lecture given by Alberto J. Mora, the former General Counsel to the United States. And I think he's here today. So welcome back. His remarks, his lecture, was so thought-provoking, timely, and incredibly important for understanding current world events and our current situation. So we were deeply appreciative of what you did for us last year. Thanks for being here. I knew at that point that this event was something special and something that would grow in deep importance to Florida State University. It's something we need. So I'm very grateful to Dean Aaron O'Connor for making this possible. This lecture, at a personal level for me, also reflects the manner in which Sandy D'Alembert led this university as president and as a founder of the Center for the Advancement of Human Rights. Sandy was a passionate advocate who got things done in a passionate and pragmatic way, but loved the world of ideas and was a true citizen of the Republic of Letters. So the things he did were always grounded deeply, intellectually, conceptually, philosophically, which made him an amazing leader and also a handful as a thinker and leader. I'd like to offer special thanks, of course, to FSU Law alumna Patsy Palmer, who established this lecture series through a generous gift to the College of Law. Patsy, I'm so proud that FSU Law can offer this event to our campus and to the Tallahassee community. Thank you so much for being our partner in this and in so much else. Really deeply appreciate your decades of unselfish service to this university. And I just want to acknowledge how much I personally am grateful for your support of my work over the years. I'd also like to acknowledge President Emeritus John Thrasher, who continues to serve FSU in so many ways, especially in his role as a professor here in the law school. And we find ourselves in a very interesting position where he was my boss for most of my career here, and now, theoretically, I'm his boss now. And I emphasize theoretically in italics and quotation marks. John, you've told me several amazing stories about your friendship with Sandy, and though I can't get into those stories now, but I will say they exemplify the best in American life and academic life of two friends who held different opinions about so many things, but were intensely loyal to each other and totally dedicated to serving the community and the university. So John, welcome. I'd also like to congratulate the two students who will be recognized today. 2024 Ellis Medal recipient Robin Rodriguez and D'Alembert Ellis Fellow Nicholas Lower. We'll hear more about that later. These impressive students represent not only the excellence of our law school, but also the promising future of the legal profession. For the past year, as I mentioned, I've been looking forward to coming back for another impactful and inspiring presentation by a giant in the field of international human rights. I'll save the formal introduction of our speaker for Professor Benteke, but it's truly our honor to have Ambassador David Scheffer here with us to speak on the future of international criminal justice. I know we'll all leave with much to think about. And thank you for being a part of the life of the law school by spending time with our students today. And to you all, thank you all for being here, another packed house. I know you'll enjoy it and profit from it as much as I will. So thanks again, and go Noles.
Good afternoon from me as well. My name is Nadia Banteca, and I'm the Gary and Sal and Patches Professor here at FSU College of Law. And I have a great privilege today to introduce our wonderful speaker, truly a titan in the field of international law and human rights, Ambassador David Scheffer. Currently, Ambassador Scheffer serves as professor of practice at Arizona State University's Washington, D.C. Center, and he imparts his extensive knowledge in international law and politics to the next generation of leaders. Ambassador Scheffer's illustrious career is a beacon of excellence, marked by his tenure as the Meyer Brown Robert A. Hellman Professor of Law at Northwestern University Pritzker School of Law from 2006 to 2020. During this time, he also led the Center for International Human Rights, fostering a commitment to justice and human rights amongst his students. Ambassador Scheffer's impact on the global stage is unparalleled. As the first U.S. ambassador at large for war crimes issues from 1997 to 2001, Ambassador Scheffer was instrumental in the creation of not one, but five international criminal tribunals, including the International Criminal Tribunals for the former Yugoslavia, Rwanda, the Special Court for Sierra Leone, and the Extraordinary Chambers in the Courts of Cambodia. His leadership in the negotiations leading up to the establishment of the now permanent International Criminal Court and his act of signing the Rome Statute that served as the founding instrument of the International Criminal Court on behalf of the United States are testaments to his unwavering commitment and profound impact on international criminal justice. Now, Ambassador Scheffer's career, distinguished career, also includes significant contributions to the U.S. government, serving as the Deputies Committee of the National Security Council and as senior advisor and counsel to Dr. Madeleine Albright during the Clinton administration. His earlier work as an associate attorney at Cooter Brothers and his time in Singapore, as well as his roles with the House of Foreign Affairs Committee, the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, have all contributed to this very rich tapestry of professional excellence in international law. Ambassador Scheffer's role as the UN Secretary General's special expert on UN assistance to the Khmer Rouge Trials in Cambodia from 2012 to 2018 further solidified his legacy in the pursuit of justice. His involvement with the American Society of International Law and eyewitness to atrocities underscores his unwavering commitment to international justice. As an author, Ambassador Scheffer has made significant contributions to the literature of international law with award-winning books like All the Missing Souls, A Personal History of War Crime Tribunals, and The Sit Room, The Theater of War and Peace, published by Princeton Press and Oxford University Press, respectively. A graduate of Harvard College, Oxford University, the Georgetown University Law Center, a member of the New York, Washington, D.C., and Supreme Court bars, Ambassador Scheffer's academic and professional credentials and accomplishments are nothing short of extraordinary. Born and raised in Norman, Oklahoma, Ambassador Scheffer's journey from his roots to the global stage is a testament to his dedication in international law and profound impact on the world. Please join me in extending a warm and enthusiastic welcome to Ambassador David Scheffer.
Wow. Well, thank you very much. I don't know if I deserve all of that, but I appreciated it, Nadia. I want to thank Provost Clark and Professor Banika for that very generous set of introductions. And a special thanks to Dean O'Connor and to Professors Mark Ellis and to Darby Scott for their roles in ensuring that I am actually standing here today. I also am honored to be here with last year's recipient, Alberto Mora, whose distinguished career in the military, the law, and human rights richly deserve the recognition he received. And I'm grateful to Betsy Palmer for her generosity in endowing this lecture series. And I thank Florida State University, the provost, the vice provost, and of course the College of Law for this extraordinary opportunity. I've enjoyed the time I spent in the law school's classrooms with Professors Tessie and Dedecki today and speaking directly with extremely smart students. I'm here today because of the vision and contributions to the advancement of human rights and rule of law by Sandy Dellenbert and Patsy Palmer. I did not have the honor of knowing Sandy, as did so many others today that are here today, but I have certainly come to appreciate that during his life, Sandy, as Alberto Mora put it, relentlessly defended and advanced human dignity and human rights, among so many other accomplishments. Thank you for so gracefully describing Sandy last night at dinner, Patsy. It was such a glorious conversation we had about him, and I appreciated that. I will defer to Mr. Mora's memories of Sandy eloquently delivered during last year's lecture. It's men and women like Sandy and Patsy who made so much possible for the rest of us to strive for and sometimes achieve in the realm of human rights. We are eternally grateful for their engagement and contributions. The future of international criminal justice is a large subject to address, but during the next half hour, I want to present a few observations and proposals that may generate some interest. I welcome questions about any of the points that I raise or other issues after my prepared remarks. Following 3 years of tribunal building, or 30 years, I'm sorry, following 33 decades of tribunal building and hundreds of trials across the globe of leading perpetrators of atrocity crimes, namely genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and soon their primer, aggression. The world has been transformed. These courts of international criminal law have included the initial landmark court, the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, which was established in 1993 by the UN Security Council during the Balkans War. Then, after the Rwandan genocide of 1994, for which the 30th anniversary arrives on April 6th, there emerged the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. There followed the Special Court for Sierra Leone, the Extraordinary Chambers in the Courts of Cambodia, the Extraordinary African Chambers in the Senegalese Courts, the Special Panels for Serious Crimes in East Timor, the Special Tribunal for Lebanon, the Kosovo Specialist Chambers and Specialist Prosecutor's Office, and the Permanent International Criminal Court, which will render justice for as long as the now 124 nations party to the Rome Statute of the ICC continue to fund and support it. There also have been UN international investigative mechanisms, investigating but not prosecuting human rights violations and atrocity crimes for situations in Syria, Yemen, Iran, Belarus, Myanmar, Ethiopia, Eritrea, South Sudan, Burundi, Sri Lanka, Gaza, and North Korea. National criminal courts, particularly in Germany, France, and Spain, have used universal jurisdiction to enforce international criminal law. And the International Court of Justice has been adjudicating disputes between states over human rights treaties, including the Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide and the Convention Against Torture and Other Cruel, Inhuman, or Degrading Treatment of Punishment. Both of these historic human rights treaties bear directly on the commission of atrocity crimes and the responsibility of states to comply with and enforce codified treaty obligations. The foundation for international criminal law, its meaning and its enforcement, thus has been firmly established during our lifetimes, particularly in theory and institutionally in the tribunals created in recent decades, and a full lifetime away from the Nuremberg and Tokyo military tribunals. There is no turning back, but one would be hard-pressed to persuade the victims in so many conflict areas across the globe that their thirst for justice is being met. There are gaps to fill and many challenges to face in the years ahead. The world remains exceptionally violent, and adherence remains problematic under what I describe as atrocity law, where the law of war, international humanitarian law, international human rights law, and international criminal law intersect and overlap in the work of the tribunals. These gaps in law and practice rob victims of justice in connection with the Ukraine-Russia war, the Israel-Hamas war, the Rohingya of Myanmar, the indigenous populace of the Tigray region of Ethiopia, ethnic Armenians in Nagorno-Karabakh last year, and the tribes of Darfur in Sudan once again. I want to focus my remarks this afternoon, though, first on the Russia-Ukraine situation and then the Israel-Hamas situation, and identify some deficiencies that bear upon the future of international criminal justice. I speak only hours after the horrific news from Gaza regarding the deaths of so many during the attempted delivery of humanitarian assistance there today. It has been another day of grieving. First, atrocity law, as currently structured, grants combatant immunity even to military forces engaged in the crime of aggression. One could argue with considerable confidence that Russian political and military officers in the Kremlin and in the field have committed the crime of aggression against Ukraine's territorial integrity and political independence beginning on February 24th, 2022, and continuously thereafter to the present day. Mr. Moore spoke of this in last year's lecture. Indeed, an initial charge of aggression reaches back to 2014, when Russia participated in the occupation and annexation of Crimea and parts of eastern Ukraine. But certainly, if we focus on what transpired as of February 24th, 2022, every single movement of Russian forces onto Ukrainian territory from that date up to the present day, every single missile fired across the Russian-Ukrainian border, and every single use of military force on Ukrainian territory by Russian forces is by definition under the law an act of aggression. Yet atrocity law judges Russian use of force on Ukrainian territory as if such use is legitimate in the moment if it is directed against Ukrainian combatants in combat situations. If the Russians violate international humanitarian law by firing indiscriminately against civilian targets, which likely occurs every day, then investigation and prosecution of war crimes and crimes against humanity may follow. But what about combat between aggressor Russian forces and defending Ukrainian forces, soldier upon soldier? Can the aggressor force, the Russians, engage lawfully in combat with the Ukrainian defending forces and thus not be judged as violating atrocity law and not attract any individual criminal liability by doing so? The Russian tank commander who orders an assault on a Ukrainian military outpost is acting legally under the law of war, or at least that is how the law is structured. The Russian army can be an aggressor force, and thus its leaders are subject to scrutiny for committing the crime of aggression. But the soldiers and officers in the field who engage in combat with strictly the Ukrainian military would not be prosecuted for war crimes or crimes against humanity or genocide or aggression. I raise this point because once the issue of aggression is put aside, the Russian forces are supposed to fight under the law of war and international humanitarian law. And if they follow those rules, then international law blesses the combat as legitimate. In my view, even if the Russian forces comply with such legal rules during combat, they are on Ukrainian soil illegally and have no right to fight whatsoever. And yet one can slip into the trap of legitimizing the character of the combat, provided the law of war and international humanitarian law are followed by the Russian forces in the particular combat engagement. We certainly want them to follow such rules when in combat, but international law should first and foremost taint such forces with the original sin of aggression and delegitimize everything the Russian army does in Ukraine, including fighting the Ukrainian army in otherwise lawful combat. The crime of aggression is a leadership crime, and thus military forces below the leadership level escape accountability when they use military force against enemy forces acting in self-defense. So international criminal law effectively immunizes the tank commander and foot soldiers who are the leading edge of the crime of aggression when they are in strictly in combat with Ukrainian soldiers. Just a bit more on this. The Russians are not engaged in a just war, and thus their entire presence and actions on Ukrainian territory are illegitimate and illegal, even if they follow the rules for daily combat in the field. In short, if you were a Ukrainian soldier staring at Russian tanks advancing towards your position on Ukrainian territory, you might logically ask, why isn't that tank commander a war criminal for the sole act of engaging Ukrainian soldiers who fight in self-defense on Ukrainian battlefields? International law has no real answer to that question. The good news is that atrocity law regulates combat to protect civilians. The bad news is that the same body of law immunizes those committing acts of aggression in daily combat. Yes, they are probably following orders, but the law facilitates the aggression that so often leads to atrocity crimes in the field and injustice to those soldiers acting in self-defense. Now I turn to the Israel-Hamas war, with its impact on both Israelis and Palestinians. It has revealed weaknesses in how one determines compliance with the law of war and international humanitarian law. I will speak initially of Hamas, and then I will turn my attention to the Israeli Defense Forces. When the war started on October 7th, Hamas was immediately identified as the perpetrator of hideous atrocity crimes, including claims of genocide on Israeli territory and of acting as an aggressor force against Israeli territory and its populace. One could argue that because of its act of aggression, Hamas has no right of self-defense when responding to Israel's right of self-defense. Like the Russian forces in Ukraine, Hamas fighters are responsible for aggression on Israeli territory, and there is no logic to the argument that they can commit aggression and then retreat to Gaza and claim self-defense while persisting in their threats to Israel. At least in theory, the Hamas battalions should surrender, as they have no right of self-defense. But international law is not structured to press that point, as it focuses instead on the legalities of the daily character of combat between the IDF and Hamas. The picture has been needlessly clouded with views that Hamas acted solely as a terrorist organization and non-state actor, and thus was somehow detached from the law of war and international humanitarian law, with its fighters punishable strictly as unlawful combatants of a terrorist organization. You will remember how that turned out for us after 9/11. International law cannot be so blind to reality. Since elections in 2007, Hamas was the governing authority of Gaza. In that capacity, it administered Gaza, built hundreds of miles of tunnels throughout Gaza, and trained tens of thousands of fighters as part of a military force that committed aggression and atrocity crimes on October 7th, captured Israeli and other foreigners as hostages, used civilians as human shields in combat, hid in hospitals for sanctuary, and continued to fire missiles indiscriminately onto Israeli territory. The state of Palestine, recognized by 135 countries, is party to the Geneva Conventions, its 1977 protocols, and to the Genocide Convention. Gaza constitutes a major part of the state of Palestine. That means Hamas is obligated to comply with those treaties, just as it is obligated to comply with customary international law. The state of Palestine is responsible for enforcing such treaty obligations against Hamas. The state of Palestine also is a state party of the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court. And therefore, all nationals of the state of Palestine, including Hamas officials and fighters, are subject to investigation and prosecution by the ICC, including for atrocity crimes committed by them on Israeli territory. Two further points about Hamas. South Africa and four other states parties of the Genocide Convention brought a genocide case against Israel before the International Court of Justice in December. And at the oral arguments held in January in The Hague, representatives of both Israel and South Africa spoke before the ICJ judges, who include Judge Joan Donahue of the United States as president of the ICJ. 30 states parties to the Genocide Convention that are neither Arab nor Islamic states have recognized the state of Palestine. One or more of those countries could lodge a case at the International Court of Justice against the state of Palestine for violations of the Genocide Convention in connection with Hamas's actions on October 7. The state of Palestine failed to prevent those actions, and it has failed to punish anyone responsible for them, despite its obligation to do so under the Genocide Convention. If such an application were to be submitted, then the ICJ could join it with the South Africa case and thus adjudicate alleged violations of the Genocide Convention within the total context of the Israel-Hamas war. There also remains no clear knowledge of how many of the estimated 30,000 plus Palestinian deaths, of which an overwhelming number have been women and children, were actually men fighting for Hamas and under its command. The deaths of Hamas fighters, estimated to be in the thousands, are legitimate combat deaths under international law, unless they were trying to surrender or render hors de combat as captured prisoners or wounded, including those under medical care. Now I turn to Israel and the Israeli Defense Forces, or IDF. Israel is party to the Genocide Conventions and to the Genocide Convention and to the Geneva Conventions. It also is subject to the rules of customary international law, and its military forces are supposed to be guided by these treaties and by customary law and by IDF's own rules of engagement, which are not publicly disclosed. Since the early days of the war, I have repeatedly pointed out that while Israel has the right of self-defense and that there is a legitimate basis for combat with Hamas, the IDF needs to exercise that right in strict compliance with the law of war and international humanitarian law. In part, that means military lawyers should be scrutinizing all targeting and operational decisions in headquarters and to the greatest extent possible in the field. Every aerial or artillery bombardment of targets in Gaza should have been and should continue to be examined in advance with legal determinations of distinction, proportionality, military necessity, and humanity, which the military sometimes describes as fighting with honor. Such review should include the character of the munition being used, whether it is guided with precision, its tonnage and blast effect, and whether there is enough intelligence about exposure of civilians and civilian property in connection with its impact. Common sense and humanity must prevail. Taking out a Hamas commander at the expense of scores or hundreds of innocent civilians and or destruction of blocks of civilian property escapes any plausible justification. Dropping 2,000-pound gravity bombs, which have been supplied to the IDF by the United States, onto dense urban areas with hundreds if not thousands of civilians present, including women and children, defies legitimate explanation. And as I understand it, is not a tactic endorsed or used by the US military in modern times. Israel claims it is complying with international law, but it should have been demonstrating compliance every day with every single target and military operation on the ground, and such evidence should be available for public review. Israel should be compiling a daily record of its legal determinations aligned with its military operations so that it can explain the actions taken on every day of the war. The statements made by some Israeli officials and Knesset members belie the intent to comply strictly with international law, and in particular, the Genocide Convention, and were raised by South Africa in the ICJ case to substantiate its claim of Israeli genocidal intent. Even the longstanding instruction to IDF soldiers to protect quote-unquote uninvolved civilians leaves open to interpretation the characterization of quote-unquote uninvolved, which to some soldiers could mean that all civilians are involved in one way or another, so they must all be targets, One of the social media films produced by Israeli soldiers, among the many recordings of them cheerfully blowing up whole neighborhoods of homes and buildings, shows a group of them dancing to the mantra, "There are no uninvolved civilians." That mindset among at least some IDF soldiers sets the stage for ill-informed and questionable decisions about the use of force in the field that can violate international humanitarian law. But there is a more systemic point I want to emphasize. The obvious consequence of the Israeli military campaign in Gaza has been a humanitarian disaster characterized by serious allegations of atrocity crimes. The death and injured count and the magnitude of destruction of civilian property, cultural buildings, and infrastructure, including hospitals, easily triggers the alarm bells of international criminal justice. It is not surprising that much of the world has viewed the totality of the assault as genocide, as that is a totality judgment rather easy for the public to grasp. But where such death and destruction occurs in the context of warfare, the leap to genocide is more complicated. Remember that most of the genocides since the Holocaust have not been products of large-scale warfare. They have resulted from dictatorial regimes bent on eliminating part of their own population, including during non-international conflicts. Further, the rules of war focus on the targeting and fighting modalities of daily combat while remaining largely silent about any limits on the totality of death and destruction that can be inflicted on a civilian population, even in a war of self-defense. On the one hand, the international lawyer can advise about detailed principles of law and rules of engagement for the target-by-target and fight-by-firefight character of the warfare. On the other hand, international law is quite shallow when it comes to the larger holistic question, namely how much of Gaza can be destroyed and innocent civilians killed or injured in response to Hamas's assault and atrocity crimes of October 7 and continuing threat to Israel, even if specific military actions on any particular day could be justified under law. Did the IDF map out in advance any limitations to its military operations in Gaza aside from a daily accounting of operational legality, if that? Were there any red lines of death and destruction in Gaza beyond which the principle of proportionality would be invoked on a holistic rather than target-by-target basis? Were the gravity of deaths, injuries, destruction, and humanitarian catastrophe in Gaza envisioned by military planners? And if so, were the determinations made as to whether Israel would restrain its operations if that red line were crossed, even if Hamas was not entirely defeated in the field? Even the legitimate tactic of requesting evacuation of civilians from combat zones to spare their lives has to be evaluated as the war continues to determine how any particular evacuation can be managed safely and with humanitarian integrity in a crowded urban setting. And significantly, will the civilian population be threatened by starvation as the warfare continues? My point is that the underlying principles of international law should be reviewed to ensure that compliance with individual targeting and combat rules does not obscure the overall societal impact of the warfare over time and whether that total impact can be justified. That may require a rethink about what winning a war actually entails and how high a price in the character and totality of death and destruction can be inflicted to achieve victory and ensure future national security in compliance with international law. The United States certainly made that decision regarding the firebombing of German and Japanese cities and the dropping of the atomic bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki during World War II and the use of Agent Orange and napalm during the Vietnam War. Yet the spiraling evolution of international law and international criminal justice since then requires a different calculus in war planning today. The protection of civilians and their property is of paramount importance, even in complex situations involving urban warfare, and enemies who do not respect international law at all. And that means that waging legitimate warfare is under much greater and more challenging scrutiny. I distinguish my point from how atrocity crimes are prosecuted against individuals on trial before the international and hybrid criminal tribunals. Gravity and magnitude of criminal conduct is paramount. The holistic character of the death and destruction is factored into determinations of whether a particular atrocity crime was committed and whether the accused was instrumental in such conduct and outcome. For example, for genocide, one must combine both genocidal acts with genocidal intent, which must be to destroy all or part of an ethnic, national, racial, or religious group as such. For crimes against humanity, there must be commission of designated crimes as part of a widespread or systematic assault directed against a civilian population with knowledge of the attack, which typically involves a situation of considerable magnitude. The Rome Statute of the ICC looks to the commission of war crimes as being part of a plan or policy, or as part of a long-scale commission of, or wide-scale commission of such crimes. The chief prosecutor of the ICC, Karim Khan, will have all of these gravity factors in mind during his team's investigations of both the Russia-Ukraine and the Israel-Hamas situations. Thus, when strategizing legitimate acts of self-defense under the UN Charter, there should be a calculation about the magnitude of the action and its impact on society as a whole, particularly innocent civilians and their property. Strategists should try to envision the end game and the totality of death and destruction that may result, and then calculate red lines beyond which their forces will have to modify their operations to avoid essentially catastrophic impact on the civilian population. The use of artificial intelligence might be useful in this respect. Some calculations may point to an outcome where the enemy is neither totally defeated nor eliminated, but it has become obvious that other societal priorities must be factored in to further combat scenarios. International law needs to address this joust between just war and humanitarian imperatives far more directly and explicitly than it does now. And part of that modernization exercise needs to clarify when a nation's assistance to another nation crosses the line to aiding and abetting actions that can be challenged as violations of international law. Recent efforts in the US Senate to condition provisions of munitions to Israel to ensure that the Leahy Act is complied with, as well as an executive memorandum issued by the White House recently that reiterates review of arms transfers to ensure compliance with US and international law, emphasize some cautionary procedures. There needs to be a very serious effort now to examine how international humanitarian law and the law of war in particular should be modernized to help guide the conduct of nations as they are challenged to uphold human rights while using military force to defend human rights. Another major issue I want to address today in my final 5 minutes is double standards in America's role in advancing international law, including international human rights law and international criminal law. Granted, this is an old problem between the United States and much of the rest of the world. In so many discussions I have had about the ICC and US policy over the years, particularly dialogues with foreign scholars, lawyers, think tankers, diplomats, journalists, there arises the constant refrain that American invocations about international criminal justice fall on deaf ears overseas, particularly in the global south, because of the foreign perception of double standards. One of the clearest examples of this problem today is the effort that I've been deeply involved in for 2 years, as has Professor Ellis, to create a special tribunal for the crime of aggression against Ukraine. The global south points to the Anglo-American invasion of Iraq in 2003, without Security Council authorization, and the use of torture in Afghanistan, at foreign black sites, and at Guantanamo during the so-called War on Terror, to charge hypocrisy and double standards in our attempt to hold Russia accountable for the crime of aggression or even for torture in Ukraine. There is deep resentment that the United States intensively negotiates international treaties, signs many of them, and then often fails to follow through with ratification. These are very, very deep scars overseas. While I was negotiating the Rome Statute, other negotiators often would press me in sidebar discussions about perceived American hypocrisy in the peculiar American failure to commit. They would remind me that they reopened the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea at President Ronald Reagan's insistence to revise the deep sea mining provisions. But once they met US demands and ratified the treaty amendments, the United States never followed through with ratification of that critical treaty. And yet today, our government relies heavily on the rights protected by that treaty, albeit claiming they are customary international law, to ensure US commercial and military access and freedom of navigation of the high seas. The United States would begin to overcome the double standards perception, which cripples our influence on so many fronts, including international criminal justice, if the US Senate were to follow through on major treaties that the United States took the lead in negotiating and then often signed. These include the Convention on the Law of the Sea, the additional protocols 1 and 2 of the 1949 Geneva Conventions, drafted in the aftermath of the Vietnam War, the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, a practical duplicate of the American Disabilities Act championed by Senator Robert Dole, who also supported the treaty, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. These are all treaties joined by almost every other country in the world. And I would add to the need to get done list the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, American pleas and invocations to other nations about compliance with international law and the pursuit of international criminal justice might finally avoid deafening rebuttals of double standards. Most of these unratified treaties have been languishing for decades. It's been 24 years since the United States signed but not yet ratified the Rome Statute. Despite some flaws in its performance, the ICC has demonstrated its credibility, competence, fairness in protecting due process rights, reasoned jurisprudence, the will to institute reforms, and a mixture of convictions and acquittals. It also is demonstrating every day its relevance in a highly dynamic and violent world. All of Europe, all of Latin America, most of Africa, the Caribbean and Central America, and a good number of Asian and Pacific nations are committed, ratified states parties of the ICC. An overwhelming number of these states parties are our allies and friends in the world. But the ICC would operate even better and advance international criminal justice far more effectively if its membership were universal or at least closer to that goal. The United States can still set the right example. Republicans and Democrats on Capitol Hill have supported, with legislation that became law more than a year ago, American assistance to the ICC to investigate atrocity crimes in Ukraine. While I doubt any similar initiative would emerge to assist the ICC's ongoing investigation of the Israel-Hamas war, the fact is that the ICC plays a critical and highly professional role in examining the actions of Hamas, both in Israel and Gaza, and of the IDF in Gaza. The more the United States engages with the ICC, the more our own eyes can focus on and assist their investigative work. It matters if you are in the sandbox with the others, particularly if they are your allies and friends. If you stand outside the sandbox that you actually helped build, whining and carping, the simple reality is that no one cares what you have to say, regardless of how self-righteous or exceptional you think you are. As a predicate to US ratification of the Rome Statute, I have publicly proposed several steps, but I emphasize two of them here, and I conclude with these remarks. First, for many years, Senator Dick Durbin, chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, has advanced bipartisan legislation to fill the gaps in federal criminal law for genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. As the gaps are filled, the United States can demonstrate its capacity to investigate and prosecute the atrocity crimes found in the Rome Statute, and thus, if addressed competently, avoid ICC scrutiny. This is part of the design of the Rome Statute, and it is the same goal shared by our allies, which are almost all states parties to the Rome Statute and have amended their criminal codes accordingly. Durban has almost reached the finish line. Laws of essentially universal jurisdiction to cover any foreigner setting foot on U.S. soil have been adopted for the commission of genocide since 2007, when Senator Durbin joined with the late Senator James Inhofe of Oklahoma to co-sponsor the Genocide Accountability Act. In addition to bipartisan laws on recruitment of child soldiers and human trafficking, the Justice for Victims of War Crimes Act, adopted in late 2022 under the co-sponsorship of Senators Charles Grassley of Iowa, Lindsey Graham of South Carolina, and Senator Durbin of Illinois, finally subjected foreigners who commit war crimes to the jurisdiction of U.S. federal courts if they set foot on U.S. soil. Under this new law, the Department of Justice recently indicted four Russian soldiers on war crimes in Ukraine. So don't look for these indicted war criminals anytime soon in Disney World. The next step should be a Crimes Against Humanity law. The legislative text of which has been approved throughout the administration, including at the Pentagon, and for which Senator Durbin now seeks a Republican co-sponsor, as he insists on bipartisan buy-in, just as with the other gap-filling laws. If adopted, this legislation would be the first opportunity to bring crimes against humanity into the federal criminal code, prevent the United States from being a sanctuary for anyone of any nationality who commits a crime against humanity, and better insulate this country from ICC scrutiny. Second, the National Security Council should chair an interagency task force to draft declarations to the Rome Statute as preparation for ratification that would address key U.S. interests, including adherence to the U.S. Constitution and to full complementarity with the U.S. judicial system, meaning deference to U.S. prosecutions, a principle built into the Rome Statute. Senators undoubtedly would craft their own declarations, and we should not shy from that possibility. While reservations are not permitted under the Rome Statute, declarations are possible. An initiative to draft declarations, which many nations have employed when ratifying the Rome Statute to protect their national interests, would be a pragmatic and constructive means to mold acceptable terms for ratification of the Rome Statute before the U.S. Senate. My hope is that it will not take another quarter century before the United States is part of the International Criminal Court. The fact that it took the United States 40 years to ratify the Genocide Convention in 1988 is an unacceptable precedent in American history, and we should not strive to repeat it. Atrocity crimes are the scourge of our times, and the United States should be proudly and confidently at the forefront with our allies and friends, bringing perpetrators of such heinous acts to justice and ensuring that our countries are not safe havens for such individuals. My time has expired, and I am in your hands now for questions. And again, thanks for the opportunity to deliver this lecture.
Thank you, Ambassador Scheffer, for your very thoughtful as well as thought-provoking remarks. We now have a few moments for questions. If you desire to submit a question, there is a QR code on the back of your program that will take you to a form that will allow you to submit a question electronically. There are also signs around the room with the QR code that will take you to the same form. If you prefer to do it the old-fashioned way, that's okay. There are pieces of paper and pens up on the table, and you're welcome to bring me a question that way as well. So we have one question that was submitted earlier today, and this is certainly an extension of the conversation you were just sharing with us about your thoughts about why it is so critical for the United States to ratify the Rome Statute. So the question is, when do you think that will happen?
Well, I want it to happen in my lifetime, so that's my goal. I just don't want to leave the earth without it having happened first. So maybe another 20, 25 years. And it may take that long. But I do think the tide can turn. You know, the arc of international criminal justice is very, very long. Obviously, you know, bringing individuals through the process, investigating, indicting, trying, convicting or acquitting, takes sometimes decades. For the United States, however, I do think that we're reaching a critical, that favorite word that we're all using these days, you know, that critical inflection point, where our credibility to actually make our views convincingly persuasive to much of the rest of the world, we're there. I mean, there's no point in preaching these principles, these rules, these conventions, the law of global affairs, without being a full participant in that. And I just hope that we can reach that point soon. I do think it was so encouraging when we reached the point a year ago where so many senators who had been quite critical of the ICC suddenly saw that there was great value to it and supported U.S. assistance to the ICC in the Ukraine conflict. That doesn't mean that the United States has to, be all feet in on everything that the ICC may wish to investigate. After all, the states parties to the treaty have a vast range of different views about issues that the ICC is investigating, and they have those views based upon their political relationships and their foreign policies, et cetera. But we're talking about an institution of the rule of law, and having the United States and its expertise as part of that institution, I think, is an imperative that is arriving sooner than later. By the way, I have always argued, my goodness, from the very beginning of the negotiations in the mid-1990s, that if the United States were to become a party to the Rome Statute and thus of the court, we should put, I mean, we would have the clout, I can assure you, to, I think, ensure that an American could be elected judge to the ICC. And I have argued that it should be one of our top judge advocate generals of our military, one of the top ones. Put them in. Put Alberto Mora on the bench, for God's sakes. And because that panel of judges can benefit from the perspective of military law, which we know in spades in this country. And I just think that would be a very helpful addition to the panel of judges of the court.
Thank you. Another question is geared towards students, and it is, what is one piece of advice you would give to law students who want to pursue a career in international criminal law similar to yours?
I get that question about once a week from my students, and it's very understandable. And I say there are so many different paths, but I'll just briefly say this, because these are just some tips to give to the students, which is, first, yes, do try to study some of it in law school, but do study all the fundamentals, because those are the most important aspects of your becoming a lawyer. You can always, for example, get a master's degree in law in international comparative law. That's what I did, and it was enormously helpful. It just focused me for an entire year full time to get that LLM on the subject that I loved. And that set me up, quite frankly, in many ways to get my feet in the door in various offices, because I walked in with that LLM supplementing my basic law degree. So keep LLMs in mind. But secondly, I practiced with an international law firm, which doesn't exist anymore, but it was the best in the world when it did, Cudair Brothers. And I did it for 8.5 years. And I learned how to become a lawyer, how to become an international lawyer. And that experience has been invaluable to me for the rest of my career as I turned my attention to public international law and to this field of international criminal justice, because you have the skills of being a lawyer and you have confidence as a lawyer. And that's very, very important. So don't shirk away from going into the law firms. But if you do go to the law firms, seek out pro bono work. They're going to want you to do pro bono work, and you can easily get your feet into international law, particularly, immigration law, obviously, but in so many other ways. And I'll just briefly tell you, early in my time with Kuder Brothers, they sent me to the Singapore office for 4 years. And while I was there, during the first year, was the collapse of the situation in Cambodia. The starvation was just rampant among the Cambodian people. And my pro bono project was to draft the charter parties for the barges that delivered the rice from Thailand to Cambodia to feed the Cambodian people. And I can't tell you, that was such an inspiring thing to do, to just spend a few hours of the day or even of the week just doing kind of drudge work, you know, charter parties. But yeah, it's for a good purpose. It feeds people. And so you can get yourself into that mode very, very quickly. My final suggestion is, of course, if you're interested in the tribunals and you want to do litigation, et cetera, a famous prosecutor of the Yugoslav tribunal, Mark Harmon, once told me, you know, he had started his career out as a public defender in San Francisco. Then he jumped to the Department of Justice, did some environmental crimes, including the Exxon Valdez off Alaska. And then he volunteered for the Yugoslav Tribunal. But he said it was his 10 years as a public defender that made him the lawyer that he became. He said it's the best experience you can possibly imagine to become a litigator at the tribunals, is to be a public defender first.
All right, great. Maybe we'll do one more question, and then there are a lot more than we have time for, and so I encourage you to stick around for the reception and take the opportunity to speak directly with Ambassador Scheffer following this. The final question is going to be, what recourse does the ICC have when a country ignores its decision?
Oh, well, it can go to the Security Council and seek a response from the Security Council to assist the court in enforcement of the court's judgments, which frankly, I guess now that I focus on your question a lot, Darby, what you're really asking is the ICC delivers I think what you're really asking is the situation, because if you convict someone, you already have custody of them and you just imprison them, you know, possibly for the rest of their life. That's not an enforcement problem. I think the real enforcement problem is where the ICC, for example, is working a situation where the Security Council has referred that situation to the ICC, which it's entitled to do, and did so with Darfur, the genocide there in the early 2000s. And then with Libya, the threat that Gaddafi posed to Benghazi and its civilian population in 2011. And what I have always been so distressed about is that the Security Council never really followed through to help the court deal with Darfur, deal with the indicted war criminals from Darfur. And that included the president of Sudan, al-Bashir. How do you gain custody of al-Bashir? Because this is under Security Council direction. This is mandatory, Chapter 7 of the UN Charter. You're supposed to follow that, period. And so the court had the power of the UN behind it. And the Security Council, for reasons that you can all imagine, the politics of it, which deteriorated over the last 10 to 15 years, simply has never followed through to really assist the court on a situation like Darfur.
Thank you so much. With that, I'll turn it over to Dean Aaron O'Hara O'Connor for our final remarks. Thank you so much, Ambassador Scheffer.
Thank you for joining us today for this lecture, Ambassador. We're very honored to have you here, and I know by devoting an entire career to your work, you have seen and witnessed some of the darkest of humanity, and yet you bring this commitment and this sense of hope and joy at being able to feed the starving and bring justice to the world. And I'm so heartened to see your hope that the United States will step up in this area one day. Thank you for joining us today.
I want to recognize a couple students. Before I do that, though, I really want to provide heartfelt thanks to two of our alums, Patsy Palmer and Mark Ellis. The two of them, together with Sandy Downbear, have done so much on their own to further human rights in the world, but importantly, to further the human rights education and offerings that we have here at the university, and specifically at the law school. And the three of you have teamed together to do amazing things like ensure the funding and the support for the University Center for Advancement of Human Rights, to teach multiple courses, to mentor our students, to provide funding for international opportunities, to provide funding for conversations like we have today, to ensure that we have a clinic devoted to international human rights and to help our faculty further their education and expertise in the area. It really is changing lives. And is really placing a mark on Florida State University here in Tallahassee, Florida, like the last place maybe you would expect to be a beacon for international human rights, and yet it's becoming just that. So thank you so much for all that you do. And included in their support in the area, it has been the creation of the Ellis Medal, and this is a medal that we started awarding last year. It's an annual medal that is provided to the graduating 3L student who has done the most to further their education in international law and to embrace experiences in international law and international human rights more specifically. This year's Ellis Medal recipient is Robin Rodriguez. Robin has done a number of amazing things here at the College of Law. In the summer of 2022, she was enrolled in the International Human Rights Advocacy Clinic. In the spring of 2023, she enrolled in the International Human Rights of Women Upper Level Writing Course. Her work in both of these spaces was exemplary, stellar, I'm told, from her professor. She received the D'Alembert Ellis Fellowship last year, so she was the inaugural recipient of that fellowship. The fellowship awards a financial stipend to a student who undertakes international human rights law internships in developing countries. It is a competitive process. She was selected last summer, and she interned at the Human Rights Advocacy Center in Accra, Ghana. So, Robin, I would love to present you the medal. And I hope you're all able to stay for the reception afterwards so she can show you that medal. It is gorgeous. It's really beautiful. I also wanted to recognize this year's D'Alembert Ellis Fellow, Nicholas Lower. Nicholas is receiving the fellowship. This is funding for an international human rights experience this summer. Nicholas will be interning with the Extraordinary Chambers in the Court of Cambodia for a period of 3 months this summer. Is Nicholas with us? He's in London. Okay. Well, hopefully he's joined us virtually with, I'm told, several hundred others. So if you're with us virtually, congratulations, Nicholas. I want to thank you all for joining us today. Please stay for the reception, and hopefully we can have some more conversation about today's topic. Thank you.